Brooks at page number 442. Brother Aaron, come up here and take this offering up, please. Brother Strange, would you please pray over this offering?
Lunch is this Friday. We're having chili mac, and so I'm sure there will be salad with that, probably some grilled bread of some sort. Mark chapter 1, beginning with verse 39. Usually when Wednesday night's over, I run, and I put a mark where we ended, and I didn't. And so this is where I think we ended last week. And if I repeat something I said before, I apologize. And he preached in their synagogues through all Galilee and cast out devils. So he's preaching, he's casting out devils, and there came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou can make me clean. The Romans had divided the land of Israel into three separate regions, Galilee, Samaria, and Judea. Galilee was the northernmost region, an area about 60 miles long and 30 miles wide, and Jesus did most of his ministry in that area. It was an ideal place for him to teach because there was over 250 towns concentrated in that area. And because there was 250 towns, there would have been a lot of synagogues where Jesus could proclaim his message, the good news. Many of the towns were marketing villages that served the rich agricultural community. And the Jewish historian Josephus notes that even the small towns had about 15,000 people. I was raised in a small town of about 2,000. But their small towns had about 15,000, according to Josephus. Though they were the size of towns, they had the dynamic of really a village, because a lot of people was rural, and they were coming into the towns with their goods. And so it wasn't like we think of an inner city, even though it was that many people. And so Jesus is casting out demons. And when he does this, what do you think the message is that is coming across to the people? I mean, is this something that they see all the time? Okay, so something uncommon is happening. What does this say about Jesus? Because it says more than one thing about him.
He's different.
Okay, he's different because something different is happening. Anyone else? He has authority to do what others are not doing. Anyone else? He's having compassion to a group of people that perhaps are not usually getting compassion. So this does say a lot about Jesus. He's different from other teachers. He's different from other rabbis or ministers. He's different even from other prophets. He's different from John the Baptist. He has an authority that is different, and his compassion is staggering. Now, knowing that he's different, that might mean something to a leper. Because what hope does a leper have in Jesus' day? Okay, now, I'm hearing two things. I'm hearing none from everybody and to be healed from mama. So let me clarify this. If it wasn't for Jesus, it would be none. But because of Jesus, there is a hope there. That hope is because Jesus is different. That hope is because Jesus has authority that other people don't have. And that hope is because Jesus has compassion that other people perhaps don't have. And where people typically compassionate towards the lepers? No. They kept them at more than just an arm's length. And a lot of that was fear. They were afraid of them because they didn't want to catch what they had, because the consequences was not just serious from a physical standpoint, but from a spiritual standpoint in the law, they were alienated from the congregation that could go and worship the Lord with everybody else. So it was a very, very serious thing. And now, we come to this gentleman, this leper, who comes beseeching Jesus. What does that word make you think? Beseeching. Begging. Pardon me? He's searching for Jesus. But he's found him here now. But he was searching for him, and he found him. And now he's begging, pleading, crying out. He's beseeching him. He's kneeling down. What does that indicate? Okay. Okay, we're getting a couple things here. Okay, we're getting a whole bunch of things here. We're getting respect, submission, humility. What did you say? Submission. I already quoted yours then.
I said he recognized his deity.
Okay. He may have recognized his deity, but he may not have. If he's worshiping, then perhaps so. But if he's just simply begging a person because there's just a small chance, it may not be that he recognizes deity, but he certainly recognizes authority and perhaps compassion. I know some people that have compassion. My wife has compassion. I think she's a fairly compassionate person. But that don't mean she wants to babysit your kids all the time. Okay? Now, let's just go down this path just for a little bit. My wife, for a while, had somebody kept wanting them to babysit their children. But they didn't want to pay her anything to do it. They just expected her to do it because she was a spiritual person and kind. But my wife felt like her time was as valuable as everybody else's. And why would she do this constantly for nothing when that wasn't her responsibility? And you're robbing her of her opportunity to fulfill her own responsibilities. And so do you know what happened? She stopped answering that phone call. Because we got called around to eat. And my wife started figuring out the only time she got called from this person is if they wanted her to do something for them. And even though my wife loved this person's children, because she did love their children, she could not go down that path. Okay, so the reason I say this is just because somebody has compassion doesn't mean they can meet your need. And even if they could, it doesn't mean that they want to. Boy, I could do a whole sermon on that concept right there. Because sometimes people expect all kinds of stuff out of people in ministry just because they're the pastor. And you know what? Our heart is to serve. And so most likely we'll be abused if we're not careful. It can happen. Okay? Well, here we come to this person, and he's coming to Jesus, and he says, "If thou wilt, thou canst make me clean." So he doesn't doubt Jesus' ability, because he's basically saying, if you are willing, if thou wilt, you can do this. Okay? So, I think inside of this statement that the leper is making, because all he said is, if you want to, you can do it. He hasn't even directly said, please do it. He's just letting him know that if he wants to, he can do it. That's almost to me like the leper saying, do you care enough to meet my need? Are you willing to go down this path? I believe you have the ability, but that doesn't always mean God's going to do what we want, does it? Not always. So that makes me think that when he's kneeling before him, that element of submission is center front. Whatever he chooses to do, that's up to him. But that man has put himself in the place where he's saying, I know you can. I know you can. And it says in verse number 41, and Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him. Everybody say, that was a sad. That's where all the air gets sucked out of the room. You understand that's no small thing. Why? It was against the law. Why was it against the law? Okay, this man is unclean, potentially contagious, and it broke what would have been considered a quarantine type of a law. How much does Jesus care for him? Enough to touch him. How many times do you think this leper had been touched before? Maybe when he was little, before he started manifesting this disease. A person could get this as they became an adult or even later. The word leprosy in the biblical times encompassed a wide range of skin conditions. Today we have something called leprosy, which is Hansen's disease. And it is a very specific thing, and it's horrible. Old Testament leprosy would have included what we call leprosy today, but it would have also included more things that was skin related. So I don't know exactly what his dilemma was, but it could have been horrible. It could have made him disfigured. Now today we know that a lot of skin diseases can sometimes be accompanied by arthritis and other things. If it's your immune system that's attacking your skin, then it can attack other things in your body. So the man's life was most likely fairly miserable, even if it wasn't for the fact that people wouldn't touch him. But there's something about human touch. I don't want you touching all over me. But there's something about human touch. Even when you shake somebody's hand and say, it's good to see you, there's a connection that happens there. And for somebody like him, that connection had been broken for a long time. And when he says to Jesus, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean, Jesus could have said, be clean. Now, you know what I'm saying? But Jesus didn't. Jesus was very personal towards him. So he was ritually unclean, and you'll find that in Leviticus chapter 13, verse number 3. Jesus was willing to incur ritual defilement in order to do it. But that tells me something about Jesus as well. He's willing to get down in the dirt if it means he can lift you up. Well, we see that in his life. He comes down, becomes dirt. That's what we're made out of, by the way. And he lives through what we live through, goes through the sufferings like we go through, so he can raise us up. He reached down and he touched this. Pardon me?
I have a question.
Yes.
Were they healed of the leper before the time of Jesus, except that of Naaman?
Was there a time besides Naaman? Yes. There was one other time that a leper was healed. There's only two recordances of a healing of leprosy. One was after the giving of the law, but it was also not to a Jewish person, Naaman. The other person was Miriam. When Miriam rose up against her brother Moses, God smote her with leprosy. And Moses prayed, and the leprosy was lifted. Those are the only two times that it was ever mentioned that it was healed. In Jesus' time, it happened frequently by comparison. And it said something staggering about him. Did I answer your question well enough?
Yes.
Okay. The whole of the gospel is there in a nutshell, because Christ redeems us from the curse by becoming a curse. Jesus healed him of his leprosy by becoming ritually defiled. But Jesus is also going to redeem us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse on the tree. And so even though they would not have understood that at that time, there was a lot in that sermon that they were watching. Verse number 43, and he straightly charged him, and forthwith sent him away. Now that's a very strange verse. Because this word straightly charged in the Greek is not mild. In fact, it seems to imply anger. Or even indignation. The text literally says that Jesus sent him away sternly admonishing him. Well, that's going to happen in the next verse after he gives him another command besides. Okay? Yes, sir.
Jesus knew what he was going to do, and so that's why he was stern with him.
Now, let's just pause a second. For the sake of everybody else, what did Jesus know he was going to do?
He knew that he was going to go and tell everybody that he wasn't going to listen to his command that he was given to him.
Oh, he was a blabbermouth.
Yeah. Well, like most of us.
Like most of us, he says. Okay. Jesus had compassion enough to heal him. But now when he's about to send him away, Jesus shows some element of displeasure, because you don't have anger without displeasure.
Right.
And he's stern with him. And a lot of people try to figure out why this was. Some people try to say that Jesus is angry and stern because he's so angry at what sin has done and brought into the world and the way it has affected people, and they spiritualize it. And I'm sure there could have been some truth to that, but really, what you just said, we know, is going to play out in the text. And it's very possible that Jesus did know what he was about to tell him to do, the man was not going to do. And so when he told him, he tells him forcefully. Okay, so what does he tell him? He tells him, in verse number 44, and saith unto him, see thou say nothing to any man. Now that man came to Jesus, and he wanted a healing. And Jesus had enough compassion, not just to heal him, but to touch him. And then Jesus knew that man was a blabbermouth, and he sternly says, don't tell anybody. Now, commentators struggle with this one because let's say you were just healed of leprosy. What's the chance you're going to keep your mouth shut? So some of them say that just like this man couldn't keep his mouth shut, when you give your life to the Lord and he saves you and delivers you, you'll have to tell people. But that misses the fact that he disobeyed Jesus. So then why in the world would Jesus say not to tell anybody and then be upset knowing that he was going to tell somebody when you would think generally God wants you to tell people?
Well, it's against the law for him to touch you, for one thing.
A lot of people that knew he was leprosy. And then all of a sudden he comes to them and he's going to have no leprosy up. He's clean. They're curious. They want to know. And he's got to tell them something. So he didn't want to lie.
Or poor leper. You're making excuses for him when Jesus was upset, but it sounds good, Dottie. I like the way you think. It's very compassionate. Okay? One second, brother. He's talking.
There was at least two times in the gospel.
Brother Matthews made allusion to the fact that later in Christ's ministries, there was times people wanted to take him by force and turn him into a king. And so just because you've done something wonderful doesn't mean that the outcome is necessarily going to be wonderful here. Okay, now before we go any further, I know that I cut you off, brother. Go ahead.
Well, whenever he told him, you know, he'd go to the priest. And that was a Jewish law. that if a leper could go to the priest and he could take an offering to him and be prayed for. And that's what he was telling him to do, to go and give the offering, just like, you know, that the priest had healed you. And not to brag it about, but he did just like what the obstinacy told him to do.
Okay, now, we haven't read that part of the text yet, but let me finish that verse. It says, "But go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them."
Yeah.
Now some people, brothers, say that not only did this man, not only was he a blabbermouth, which the very next verse lets us know he's a blabbermouth, but it's very possible, because we know he was a blabbermouth and didn't listen on the first thing, he might not have listened on the second thing either. I mean, if you're going to be disobedient on one, why wouldn't you be disobedient on both?
Yeah.
I mean, he's got family he hasn't been able to see and touch and all kinds of stuff. It's very possible that not only did he not listen to Jesus about not saying something, but he may not have listened and even went to the priests.
Right.
Okay, now Donna. Because of what this man did, Jesus is not able to do the things that he wanted to do.
Right.
They probably flogged him. He had to get away from him.
Well, people didn't hear of people with leprosy getting healed. That was like, I mean, cast a demon out of a person. That's amazing. Heal a leper? Unbelievable. That's biblical. What I mean by that is when there's a horrible disaster, they'll be like, that's biblical. You know, whatever, the drought in whatever part of the world, it's a biblical thing. It was a biblical kind of a thing for a leper to be healed, and that rare. And so for that to have happened, people are going to cram after Christ for all the wrong reasons and not give him any breathing room. And so his purposes are hindered because he did what he did out of compassion, but what the man did in response brought hardship to the will of God. Now, there's something about that that's interesting for you to think about. God could do something amazing for you, but if your response is the wrong response, you can actually be a hindrance to the work of the Lord instead of a help. So if the Lord gives you instructions, listen. You may not understand the reason. You may not understand why it would be not in the best interest of God for you to blab what you feel like God told you. But maybe when God tells you something, it's not for the world. Or if he does something for you, maybe the time's not right. Go ahead.
Okay. Now, I do not know whether he went to the priest or not.
It doesn't say.
But suppose he did, suppose he just made this also. Number one, the reason Christ told him to go to the priest is to take tests, some form of test that the priest gave him to be declared clean. Now, if he was not declared clean, just thought of this, if he was not declared clean by the priest, he still was not supposed to go around anybody else until he was declared clean by the priest. He couldn't go to the synagogue. He couldn't go to his friends, his family, so forth and on, because he was not declared clean by the priest.
What you're saying is true, but it isn't the point that the scripture is making, because the scripture is very plain that when Jesus told him to go to the priest, it says in verse 44, for a testimony unto them. When the Lord healed him, that testimony was supposed to happen, but not to everybody right here. That testimony was for the priests. Now the priest had been given a responsibility according to the law that none of them had ever been able to do. They'd never seen that kind of a miracle. And for that man to have went to the priest for a testimony to them would have said something staggering to those priests. Something is happening that is supernatural out there that is unheard of. It would have brought faith, perhaps, to a portion of the priesthood. And so the purpose of Christ in healing him and sending him to the priest, even though, yes, the process of that was for him to be ritually cleansed according to the law, but what Jesus says, it's for a testimony to them. Go ahead. Yes, you do. Go ahead.
Okay.
You don't have to lie about it, brother. Just put it out
all
there.
All the miracles that Christ did.
Yeah.
Only made the priests and the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin just that much more mad, angry, and wanted to kill Christ even more. I don't think it would have done not one thing to the priest. I still hold to the fact that he wanted to show himself to the priest so that he could be declared clean.
According to the law, that is part of showing yourself to the priest, yes. But what the scripture says here is for a testimony to the priests. Okay, so what you're saying is true according to the law. But what Jesus said to him personally was for the sake of the priest. Now, in the book of Acts, we find out that there are priests who become part of the faith. Okay, so just to say they wrote Christ off is a very broad brush. Just like Nicodemus even came to Christ, but he was part of a group that largely rejected Christ. Apparently there was a purpose here for him to show that to the priest there. And so both is true. It is true that according to the law, you would go for your own purpose. But sometimes God has a plan for you that's beyond the purpose for you. And it's a purpose for others as well.
God always has a system, and he has had a system for a purpose. That is for man to stay in this system and go. If I want to go see the commanding officer, I have to go through a chain of commands. And I think this is one of the reasons Jesus said, go show yourself to the priest. That was a chain of commands.
No doubt you are right. Okay. So I'm not disagreeing with that, brother. I really ain't. But I'm just saying what the text says here is the other. It is no doubt that Christ was for the law and that he wanted him to follow the law. But his purpose was greater than just simply that is all I'm saying. Okay, we agree with each other. It's a wonderful day. Okay, so I'm going to read this verse one more time and then read a little snippet that I found. It says, say thou nothing to any man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. Now I'm going to hone in on that for a testimony unto them out of the New International Commentary. This is what it says. If the priests establish that healing has taken place and accept the sacrifice for the cleansing, but fail to recognize the person and power through whom the healing has come, they will stand condemned by the very evidence by which they have been supplied. In other words, if he would have went to the priest and he would have brought his offering and he would have went through the process of cleansing, because really, they would take an examination, they would quarantine you a little bit longer and look again. I mean, there was more than just a one-shot deal there. But in the process of it, it wasn't simply validating that the man had been healed, it was validating the healer. And so for a priest to go through the process according to the law, but to reject Christ would not have made sense. See what I'm saying? So for him to go to the priest and the priest to see that, what condemnation they would be under if they did reject Christ. Perhaps some of the lepers that did go to them, because this isn't the only leper that's healed, maybe some of those priests were the ones in the early church that became followers of Christ because they couldn't reject the healer. I don't know. All I know is the Lord wasn't just concerned about him, he was concerned about the priests. was concerned about both. But let's get back to the blabbermouth. Verse 45, but he went out and began to publish it much, and the blaze abroad the matter, insomuch that the Lord could no more openly enter into the city, but was without in desert places. And they came to him from every quarter. Now, here's a thought for you. Earlier in this chapter, last week, we were looking at the man who was demon-possessed. Do you remember this? And the demon cried out, "We know who thou art." Remember that? And the Lord says, "Be silent." The demons could not speak once the Lord silenced them. But men will go where demons can't. I mean, really, this happens right on the heels of the demons being silenced and being under the authority of the one who has authority. And here is a man who has authority to heal, but the man won't submit to his authority to tell him what to do. There's a lot of thought about that. Because there's a lot of people that will run to Christ and they'll say, "Oh, forgive me of my sins." Or they'll run to him and say, "Oh, heal my child. They're sick," or whatever. And sometimes God does it, and then they don't want to do whatever the Lord wants them to do. Even a demon has to listen to the Lord if he tells them what to do. We have to be careful because we've been given a gift called free will. There's a lot of responsibility with that. Responsibility. One other thought here. The Bible never speaks of healing leprosy. You'll never find it. It always speaks of cleansing leprosy. Part of the reason may be the loathsome nature of the disease, but a more likely explanation is that leprosy is a symbol of sin, and sin must be cleansed. And this episode implies that Jesus can forgive sin, because the connection, even for the Jewish thought, between leprosy and sin was like this. And it sets the stage work for what's going to happen in the beginning of the next chapter. Okay, what time is it? That is horrible. Okay. Let's go to Mark chapter 2, verse 1 and through 12, except we're not going to go very far. Now, at the beginning of this, it just says, and again he entered into Capernaum after some days. That is very generic. After some days. If you go to people that try to line up the scriptures, like, trying to think of what it's called, they take the synoptic gospels and they try to line them up so that you figure out what happened chronologically. Pardon me? It's like a timeline, yes, but there's a word for it. I have a couple of the books in my office. I can't think of the name. Anyhow, they place the teaching that Christ gave on the Sermon on the Mount in between chapter 1 and chapter 2 here. Okay, so some time has went by and some ministry goes by. But when Mark collates the information, he does it strategically to help get a train of thought across here. So he's building a case. And the case he's just built with a leprosy, where leprosy is only cleansed, not healed. And it, because of its connection with sin, takes us right over here to chapter 2. Where we're going to have a man let through the roof, and Jesus is going to say, "Thy sins are forgiven." See the connection there? So he strategically organizes his stuff to get a train of thought across. Verse 1 and 2, chapter 2 of Mark. And again, he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. By the way, there's a lot of people that really dive into what the house is. Some people think it was Peter's house. Some people think that Jesus may have, for a period of time, had his own house there. I'm not going to get into all of it because it doesn't really matter which house it was. But he goes into the house, and straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them. No, not so much as about the door, and he preached the word unto them. Okay, so let's talk about the house for a little bit. Does anybody know what a house would have been like in the biblical days of Jesus?
Rock.
Like a shed. A lot of rock. Flat roofs. Okay. Donna, how many rooms does your house have?
Mine?
Yeah.
One, two, three, six.
Is that including basement?
No.
Oh, and you have a basement besides. It's as big as the top. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, your house has six rooms on one level and then a whole other level underneath of it. Whether there's rooms in that, I don't know. But partially finished that. That's a big house for one lady to live in. But you know how women are. They like their stuff. Okay, so I'm not faulting you. But what's the likelihood that in Jesus' day a person would have had a house that big?
I'd like to say something real quick. When we were over there, we went into one of the Brother Smith and I went into one of the houses.
Yeah.
And half the house, they had a fence built up. And their sheep and goats lived in one half, and they lived in the other. Dirt floor and everything.
Okay, how big was the inside of the house?
Oh, the house all together was maybe 20 by 30.
How many rooms?
Two. Well, one big room, but it was...
Okay.
About there.
Most of the houses in Jesus' day was one big room. Now, sometimes there was an area that was raised up just a little bit that they could sleep in. Up here, and they would bring their animals in because they didn't want anybody to steal them. Okay? And so if they had a donkey or if they had some pigs or whatever, cows, they're not going to have no pigs. Okay, so whichever animals they're going to have in there, their chickens, they're going to bring them into the house, shut the door, and then they don't have to worry about anybody stealing them. That's kind of smart. Okay? And so even if it was in a town, they might would have, for transportation, an animal that you would bring in. Have them warm at night, too. Snuggle up to that cow or whatever. Okay, so the houses were small. That helps you to understand how very swiftly a house could be overrun by a whole bunch of people. See, if you come to our house, we got a pretty big house. We got a big living room, and there's a little sitting room where Mama is. And we've got a couch, another couch, we've got some chairs, we got a fairly good-sized dining room. If a whole bunch of people came in to our house, we could fit a lot of people. We could probably fit everybody in our church between upstairs and downstairs if we're willing to stand and sit and not move all around. Really, it couldn't have happened in Jesus' day. Couldn't have happened. So when this message gets out about Jesus, and he's coming back to Capernaum, by the way, which is where the demon-possessed person was delivered, and where he had to get away because he went out to desert places, if you remember that, and now he's healed a leper on top of it, and he's coming back to Capernaum, you can just imagine what's happening there. It says, it was noised that he was in the house. Okay. I don't know if he managed to sneak in at night or what, but apparently when he got in, he did it without everybody knowing it. But somehow or another, the word began to spread. Jesus is in the house. And straightway, many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. In Luke chapter 1, every time Jesus preaches or does something miraculous, the crowds clamor for him in a very positive kind of way. But once we hit chapter 2, Mark is going to pull it together where in chapter 2, he faces opposition over and over and over from religious people till that when you get to chapter 3, they're plotting to kill him already. Chapter 1, they're all clamoring for him because of his miracles. Chapter 2, the people are clamoring, but the religious leaders are being antagonistic and questioning and critical. Chapter 3, they want him dead. He preaches the word. That's the end of verse number 2. He preached the word unto them. The message was his priority. And there were often miracles that followed, but he had a message that needed to be delivered. Ivor Powell, a minister who's deceased, but before he died, he wrote 4 books, one on Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. I wished he would have lived longer to have done the rest of it, because really his books were incredible. This is what he said. The healing of a man's soul is always far more important than the restoration of his health. But now everybody wanted the health. And sometimes they would diminish the need of the soul. You see, you can see and feel the health problem. But the soul problem, the stain on the heart, the sinfulness that's within, we can push it aside and not look at it if we want to. But Jesus' purpose was to call people to repent. And you can't call people to repent unless you put your finger on the sin. When your finger is on the sin, then there is an opportunity for repentance. And Jesus has to deal with sin. Why? Because he's going to be the Savior. His purpose is to save people from sin. So that brings us to verse number 3. I'll mention one thing about it and we'll stop because it's 8:04. And they come unto him bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born afore. That's going to take us into a very familiar story that we're going to look at next week. I will say this. The word palsy is related to the word paralysis. So if a person had palsy in the Bible, there was an element of paralysis. This person's being carried by 4 people. That sounds like he's a quadriplegic. So his physical need is enormous. And we're going to see what happens here next Wednesday evening. Any comments or questions before we close out? Okay, Sandy. Stand up and pray a prayer of dismissal.
Amen. God bless you.